Good evening and welcome to Icebreaker. I'm Sergeant Melanie Adams and I'll be your host this evening. Joining me I have Colonel Croxton from IDF, Captain Lawton from NASKEF, Colonel Gibbons from the 85th Group, and Captain McCartan from the Naval Keflavik Hospital. And remember, they have all the answers, but they can't answer the questions if you don't call. So please give us a call at 4613-4614 and 4550. Colonel Croxton, I'd like to start with you this evening. Is there anything you can tell us about the talks in Reykjavik last week?
Well, I can portray the talks on what happened last week generally. Last week on Wednesday and Thursday, the U.S. delegation, a team came out. It was led by Ambassador Van Voorst from the U.S. Embassy here in Iceland. We also had representatives from Office of the Secretary of Defense Policy there, so Secretary Rumsfeld's team. And we also had a joint staff there and a European command. And part of the focus of that those negotiations were when the European command team came out, they were able to discuss with Iceland the status of the current plan or the way ahead for the future of the defense of Iceland in the 21st century. So that comprised a lot of the discussions and the talks. And then what was really beneficial was those key players were able to get eyes on and see the magnitude and the scope of the facilities here at Keflavik. And kudos to all those who participated in that and the last minute changes and plans that occurred because the negotiations were dynamic. So because the key players were able to come out, get eyes on, it was very beneficial for everyone. And I can say that there's a lot more negotiating to happen, and that'll happen in the near future here.
That's always good to hear. It's always good when the two parties are talking. Captain Lawton, is there any information you'd like to give us from the base?
Sure. There's a couple of things, points of information I'd like to pass to folks. For the Navy personnel out there, I would ask that as you're working your plans to PCS, there's a very important document that you need to make sure you're tracking through your chain of command, and that is our TIS, our Transfer Information Sheet. Make sure that is moving smartly and getting to PSD, because that starts a lot of the things like ticketing and that departure process. I also want to mention the reserve support that is stepping into the gap for us. As we are starting to PCS folks out, we're getting tremendous support from the Navy Reserve. Lots of folks arriving, working in post office. I've had a PAO arrive. Other folks will be arriving over the month and in the months to come to help us keep some of the services provided on the base. One of the services that's being provided right now is household goods packouts. And it's pretty amazing to watch this process. It was one of my biggest concerns about a month ago, whether we were going to be able to ramp up to handle the increase to get everybody moving. In fact, the contractors are performing pretty daggone well. And our folks are tracking that on a daily basis. Just a couple of numbers for you to toss around out there. In April, we did 128 household goods packouts. On average, over years past, we've done about 30 or 40. Not that many people coming and going in an average month. 44 POVs were done in April, and that, back to the household goods, that was about almost 200,000 pounds of personal property shipped. In the month of May, we're anticipating ramping up to 1.2 million pounds of household goods and 175 vehicles. So you can see we're starting to push up our capacity, and it's going to continue to climb as we go into June and July, the heaviest months. So my hat's off to the contractors and the folks that are working that. On POVs, I would ask folks, this is becoming a bit of a contentious point. People are wanting to ship their cars out well in advance of when they PCS. What we're running into now is people are getting short notice orders, particularly in the month of May as we're working some of those issues. And people in July and August are wanting to ship their cars in May. We're going to have to ask people to slide out to the right so we can get those folks that are moving in the month their equipment, their POVs and stuff shipped. So as a basic policy, we're going to be looking to ship your POV in the month that you PCS in order to allow us to flow things out smoothly. I've got a question already, or do you want me to hold on to that?
Please go ahead, sir.
Okay, the question is dealing with the commissary. I think anybody that's been in the commissary of late realizes that there's a lot of empty shelves there. The question is, why are Icelandic tomatoes at the commissary $3 a pack? Where is the food at? And will we be compensated for this with extra pay? And I assume they mean because they're having to do some shopping off base. The commissary has had a very, very difficult time of late, not through any fault of their own. Jim Marino and his folks over there are working diligently to try to fill the gaps. But the shipper, the ship that brings in our commissary goods, keeps being delayed. And again, it was delayed this week. I'm told that it's arriving, either it arrived late today or it's due to arrive tomorrow, I believe, with a shipment for us. Jim Marino has worked to get some air shipments in to fill some of the gaps at a very, very large cost to DECA. And DECA has assured me that they're willing to do what they can to help us out. We have to remember, as we were just talking before, we're an island in the middle of the North Atlantic, and it's either got to get here by air or it's got to get here by sea. And, you know, I remember my good Air Force friends over here back in the Gulf War. 95% of everything that went to the Gulf went by sea, 5% by air for those critical items. So just like then, most of our stuff is coming by sea, and when a ship breaks at sea, it causes delays. But those folks are working on that. Why are the tomatoes so high? They're high right now because we're buying off the Icelandic economy, and most of our produce is going to be bought off the Icelandic economy. Jim told me that DECA is supplementing that, and Jim will call in here in a minute if I've got this wrong, but I think by 25%, so it could be worse without DECA supplementing, and that's what you would pay out in town. Are we going to be compensated? Right now, we're working that. The folks at IDF are working with the per diem committee to see about getting our COLA adjusted, because we are drawing down services and we are going to have to do more shopping off base, but thus far that has not kicked in. And as a matter of fact, as Colonel Croxton was mentioning before we started, COLA has actually taken another little dip, and that's due to the exchange rate fluctuating. So take your dollars, exchange them, go out in town and buy a few things, and you'll actually come out a little bit ahead maybe.
Thank you so much for addressing that. I know that's a huge, huge morale issue right now. Colonel Gibbons, what news do you have from the Air Force and the 85th Group?
Well, the things are definitely moving. As opposed to the last time we met, we have processed a significant number of the group with PCS orders. As of last Thursday, we were about 508 out of the 670 folks we have in the group. And actually, over the weekend, our MSS worked almost 24 hours a day to process the numerous RIPs that have showed up. We think some of our maintenance squadron personnel and the helicopter squadron personnel have received orders over the last 2 days, and so we're hoping those will be moving out here shortly. So I guess the good news is last week we were kind of waiting for the final batch of orders to come through, and it looks like we've gotten to that point. So that is definitely good news.
Let me just take a minute to say your MSS and your MPF are the best I have ever worked with in my 17 years in the military. They have been incredibly dedicated. I can call up at any time and ask a question, and they are very helpful, very customer-oriented, and it's been a tremendous help in all this transition.
You're not trying to get orders or a TMO shipment, are you, right now? I mean, you're not trying to fire them up because of that, are you?
No.
It's not going to work. Everybody has to wait in line.
They have been incredibly helpful, and we've had some unique case-by-case situations here in our little debt, and they have bent over backwards to help us and get orders from my people.
Well, thank you.
Yes, sir. Captain McCartan, for your wonderful people at the hospital who have been very, very customer-oriented as well, what would you like to pass out for them?
Well, I guess here in the past few weeks, as the whole logistics and egress out of Iceland has come to shape, we are in a position now where we can start to put dates on the calendar when we can start to draw back some of our services. As the population is getting smaller and as our staff starts to get smaller, we want to start to prepare to close as well. So with that being said, looking over several of the services that we offer, As I've mentioned here on Icebreaker, I think two or three times now, one of the things that we have asked people to come in for, and they've been very cooperative, is the Women's Health Clinic in terms of getting their annual physicals and pap smears done. With the numbers that we have and all the telephone calls that we have out and people on the books, we will be wrapping that up in the middle of May, on the 15th of May. Reason being so relatively early is that with such testing, it takes about 6 weeks to get results back. And we do not want to be getting results after people have left. So right now we want to make sure that we can be responsibly taking care of the results we get. So pap smears will be wrapping up on the 15th of May. The optometry clinic, with equipment being shipped out of town, will be looking to close the optometry services in the middle of July, 15 July. Similarly, with the good shape that we're in right now with the dental health and the dental readiness of all the active duty folks, we'll be looking at the dental clinic to be drawing down and probably stopping services also in the middle of July. So we'll be pushing that farther right, and by that point in time, the base population will be such that we'll be in good shape, and as we curtail those services, people won't be in bad shape at all. Now, one thing about dental that I want folks to be aware of, as I've asked people to come in for overseas screening, people have been very, again, diligent in doing that, and the books at the dental clinic are quite full. Dr. Avillo contacted me yesterday, and right now, with the booking that we have and what we're planning to do for the active duty population, for family members, we have family members that are on the books currently, and we're going to have to provide them the services they're scheduled for. But for family members, we're going to have to wrap it up at that point. So we won't be able to be scheduling family members after this, even for cleanings. Our dental hygienist has PCS'd, so we're going to have to, if we have dental care needed for family members, we'll be referring them into the Icelandic dental system. For active duty folks, dental right now is in the process of making sure people are ready to deploy, that all their dental needs are met. We are also completing the overseas screening for active duty and their families, of course. So active duty and families can still come in for the overseas screening. Another service that we're looking at in terms of needing to ramp it down in the mid-July timeframe is physical therapy. Commander Rigsby will be PCSing in the month of July, and right now he's negotiating his orders. But as he needs to move on, we'll be needing to look at closing down that service. Now, one question that has come up, and we spoke before we came on air, and that is in the pharmacy. Now, there are a couple of issues related to the pharmacy. First of all, as I've mentioned several times, we're currently in a position where people who have medication needs, we can get ahead of them by 90 days. So we can issue a 90-day supply. We do ask, however, that if you come in for a 90-day supply, don't come in 2 weeks later for another 90-day supply. That's happened in a couple of cases, and we've had to push back a bit. But the question is, when people move on to their next duty station, will their prescriptions be honored for further refills? And yes, they will. It would be a matter of, as you check into your next duty station, be certain that you have your health record with you, because your clinician here will be documenting in your progress notes exactly which medications you are on, what you should be on, plus the medication bottles that you have in hand will indicate the date that it was prescribed, how much you're supposed to be taking, how many times a day, etc. And while a new pharmacy would not necessarily be in a position to honor our refills, they would know exactly where you are and what they need to do for you. So I would just ask everybody to make sure that as you're traveling, have sufficient medications and have those handy when you see your primary care managers at your next duty station.
What about the people who are going to non-military locations, for example, a site out in the middle of a country or out in the middle of a state somewhere? Well, they can just take their military records to a civilian doctor?
They will be able to. And depending upon where you are in the country, you would be in a different TRICARE region. So I would encourage people to be in touch with us at the hospital to make sure that you can present to us where it is in the country you would be going, and we can give you the contact number for TRICARE, and they can basically give you the rules of engagement for that particular region. But do have your health records with you, and that will always serve you well for the civilian clinician that would be taking care of you.
Thank you very much. Now remember, this is a call-in show. If you've got a question for the captains or the colonels, please give us a call at 4613-4614 or 4550. Captain Lawton, you have a question, sir?
Sure do. If service members' families leave early, what kind of BAH entitlements are allowed? This is a topic we discussed just before coming on the air. Currently, right now, you are not entitled to BAH, but it is something we are working on, and it's there's two sides to this. One side is telling us that it's a fiscal law requirement and is not waiverable. Another side is telling us out of UCOM that the Army has done this in the past. My own personal opinion is it's the right thing to do, and we are not taking no for an answer. We're pushing back and trying to work this because it is a way for us to take care of the sailors and airmen that are moving their families early. And there are going to be those that are going to be here all the way through 30 September that it's not practical to keep their families here. It's also easier on the service member to not be bouncing them around, because if you stayed in family housing right now, you're not authorized. But if you moved into a BQ, you are authorized. But why go through that hassle of moving if we can work a waiver? And we're working that now, trying to work it.
What about the additional shipping for the pets? I know that was a big issue for a long time because there are a lot of pets that are trying to move at this time also. As a matter of fact, the vet is coming up a week in May and then a week in June to help with the vet certificates.
Right. The vet's coming on board, the Army vet. We are also making arrangements to have the civilian Icelandic vet come on and use the old IDF PAO facility to do that. And, of course, there's the vet that's right outside the front gate, Magnus, out there that can do those for you. I just made arrangements, or my wife did, to fly our pet back to the States, and we basically bought Rocky a ticket on Ice Air. Cost $75, and it's like paying for extra baggage. If you haven't flown Ice Air lately, and I just did over the weekend, they're now limited to 2 bags per person with a total of 50 pounds. So plan your shipments, or plan on paying a little bit extra, and that can be written into your orders. Mm-hmm. I think they said it was $30 for an extra bag or an extra 20 pounds or something. There's some fee there that Iceland Air is charging. And that's, Iceland Air is aligning itself with what other airlines are doing.
It was 50 pounds per bag, or 50 pounds
between
total?
Between 2 bags, so 50 pounds total.
That's like one of your bags, right?
Yeah.
I will have to mail some things to myself.
That is a possibility also. We have pulled that string.
I also remember in the briefing, in the mass briefing for the Air Force last week, Lieutenant Rozelle was saying that the letters are available to allow us to mail our household or our property to ourselves.
I believe they've got those over at the post office, if I'm not mistaken. If they're not there, holler at me and I'll figure out where they are.
And as always, you can send any information to us and we'll put it on Roller Channel 21 to help tell everyone. Captain McCartan, you got a question, sir?
Yes, I do. For limited duty personnel, do they need to leave before the hospital becomes a clinic? And I think probably the line in the sand of hospital to clinic maybe is not as important as we would want to have them into our system and have them worked up and prepared for transfer. The way the rules of the road do read is that limited duty personnel should not be transferred in that status. However, we obviously have certain limitations here and we're working around that. So I would say, the other piece is that with limited duty personnel, what we did with other people with special needs was we prioritized them in the egress from Iceland. So most of those people should be accounted for. I would say to anybody that is limited duty and has not had their whole limited duty status addressed to contact us immediately, because we need to get on top of that, and we will be working, the system to get you transferred to where you need to get, but we need to be on top of that now. So please contact us.
We have another question for you as well, sir.
Question is, how will overseas dental clearances be handled for children under 12? We can do the overseas screening, so we are handling those for active duty folks and the family members. So that's we've got. So just contact us. As I mentioned previously, if it is an active duty person only or an active duty person and their spouse, you can just walk in. We have sick call at 0730 each workday. If there are three or more family members, we do ask you to call 5230 to make an appointment, and then we can just work you in that way. But for overseas screening, children, we can take care of.
Very good. Colonel Gibbons, are there any special issues that Air Force members need to be aware of? Maybe, I know, for example, the out-processing people at MPF are not taking walk-ins anymore. You have to go through either Sergeant Atkins or you have to make an appointment. Are there any special issues that we need to know about for maybe packing things on base or making appointments?
No, that's what's good about this whole process. I mean, we're pretty much doing in sync with what Navy is doing, and we're working together to get everybody out here under the same flow plan. And that's the only way we're going to make it work, is that we work together in doing this. So I'm not too sure what special needs you refer to, but if there are any questions, folks have been advised to please bring them up through their first sergeants or commanders, or send and contact direct the MSS. They're very responsive. They've been, as you said earlier, doing a remarkable job with getting answers to people and making orders happen. And if that doesn't work, of course, they can come up through the command section and we'll sort it out. But fingers crossed, right now, I think we've got all the pieces at least going in the right direction.
Very good. The show is almost over, but you still do have a few minutes to give us your questions. Remember, it's 4613, 4614, and 4550. I think the problem is that they're a little intimidated by me instead of Senior Chief. Hmm. I know Captain McCartan was going to address bird flu.
Bird flu, if I could, yes. That'll be sort of my default when the show starts to get slow. But just remember that, you know, it's showbiz. Just do remember that the bird flu is an issue with the migratory birds now coming into Iceland. We're just being in close surveillance. I did communicate with the state epidemiologist from Iceland today, and there really is no earth-shattering news on that front from the Icelandic healthcare system. One thing that has happened in several places in Europe is that animals, particularly cats, have gotten into the carcasses of dead birds and have, in fact, themselves become infected with the bird flu and have died as a result. Now, for the most part, with the domestic animals here on base, we're all set, and people have good control over their animals. I would encourage folks that with some of the stray cats that may come into your neighborhood, I would really encourage you not to bring them in to feed them, just for the fact that we have no idea what they've been exposed to, and just with this virus perhaps coming into Iceland, we just want to play it very safe. So no news of the virus in Iceland, but just please be very smart in that regard. And if I could, I had one other medical-related question, if I could.
Oh, yes, please.
Just on the Navy side, there's this phenomenon called the PHA, the Preventive Health Assessment. And I know within the Navy, in order for somebody to take their annual physical fitness exam, they need to have an active PHA completed. If it's not completed, they will not be able to do their annual PFA. So I would encourage everybody to be in touch with the hospital to make sure you get scheduled for your PHA. We know there are probably between 40 and 50 active duty personnel on the base total that still need to have PHAs done before they depart. But please do come in, because if you were to leave Iceland without it, you're going to arrive at your next duty station, and if they play by the rules of the road, you will not be permitted to do your test, and you would therefore be considered a failure, and you would then be on an entirely different administrative track. So please be in touch to get your PHAs done. We're standing by. We've got the doctors prepared in their schedules to make room for you.
Thank you so much. Captain Lawton, you just received two questions?
Actually, it's one question, I believe. Will Navy service members receive priority housing at the next duty station? This is one we've been pursuing for a couple of weeks, maybe 3 weeks, and we got the answer recently. We put out word for folks to give us names and their where they're transferring to in fleet concentration areas, and how many members they have, and in fact, those folks, as we've submitted their names, are going to be bumped up on the priority list. And I think it's Well, there's a top level, and I think they're right below that level, and I can't remember the name right now of that top level, but they are going to be bumped up on the priority list, so that should work out well.
Very good. You mentioned earlier that we had some extra help with the contractor so that we could get out the 128 shipments last month instead of the 30-some. Is that going to affect the shipping, or will our goods still be on the same timeline they would be normally?
We're anticipating that they'll be on the same timeline, and it's actually the contractors, the Icelandic contractors, have stepped up their capacity for us. We anticipate that things will flow out of here, and as a matter of fact, we just got a cargo handling battalion, six folks in, to help in the warehouse of moving from the warehouse and crating and doing those kind of things to help with that the bottleneck that sometimes forms in the warehouse. From the warehouse, it's obviously got to go to the ship. Transcom and the folks at Military Sealift Command are looking at our requirements. As they know our requirements, they provide the lift assets to move it out. So I would anticipate we'll be moving on a similar timeline to what we moved in the past.
Very good. See, people, I told them we only had a few more minutes, so they're starting to call. Captain McCartan, sir?
Okay, for families staying after the clinic closes, what steps will they need to take for medical care? The plan for the after-hours care, as I'm assuming what's being asked here, we had a plan put together that was based on sort of the change in capability of the on-base telephone system. And right now we're kind of asking communications folks to look at that with us. What I'm anticipating is that we will have an after-hours number that people can call for advice. We would have the ability to provide advice, make an appointment for you for the next day, or if there were the need to seek care, we could advise you as such, you know, that you should seek care at that point in time. So that is the way we'll be working it. The whole challenge that we have at the clinic is that without a surgeon and obstetrician and other medical emergency capabilities on our staff, because they will be all departing in the June timeframe, we can't be responsibly bringing in emergency care after hours because we would not be properly staffed to take care of it. So that's why we're going to be working with our colleagues in the Icelandic healthcare system. We actually have an appointment down in Keflavik Thursday afternoon, and we're in touch with our folks up in Reykjavik. So right now here on base, as the plan is working right now with the communication system, as it stands up, as I anticipate it will, we will have an after-hours telephone number that can be called 24 hours a day. That phone will be answered by a doctor or a nurse to provide the care and give you guidance at that point.
Very, very helpful. Thank you. Captain Lawton, sir?
A couple of questions here, actually, three. One of these we've seen before. The question dealing with inspection stickers. If you have an inspection sticker on your car and it expires in May and you're due to be here till the end of September, do you have to get it renewed? And the answer is yes, you do. It's Icelandic law. And if you're going to operate the vehicle, it's got to be inspected. The next question asks, is there any compensation for MWR part-time employees? And I'm not sure exactly what compensation they're asking about, but my sense would be that since they're part-time employees, that's probably not something that is planned for being compensated for. And the last is, when is the car rental office in the Mini Mart area going to be closing down? They have told us, the car rental place has told us, they plan to be here till the 30th of September, and that's what we're planning on.
Very good. Captain McCartan, sir, you just got another question?
Yes. It just has to do with the issue of TRICARE and TRICARE enrollment. And it goes back to a point that we've made several times in terms of be certain that you do disenroll from TRICARE before you depart Iceland. That is part of your checkout procedure. And when you come through the hospital, we'll be having you check out with TRICARE. What medical coverage will you have while in transit to the next duty station? And that is actually kind of linked right into that. As active duty members and enrolled in TRICARE Prime, you are covered as you travel. It is an issue generally where if you have emergency care, present to an emergency room. If you do have a routine care or a nagging problem that's coming up, or if you're going to be seeing your family in your record of home of record during your transit, you should have the TRICARE 800 number that I don't have off the top of my head, but we can certainly provide it for you if you're to get in touch with us at the hospital. But they would be able to provide you the guidance so that you could plug in and receive care irrespective of where you are in your travels. So the whole thing of making sure that you do disenroll here, because as you disenroll, you do not get wiped out from our records. What that does is it buys you a lock-solid 45-day period where during your travels you will appear in the big computer that we all log into at the military healthcare system, and they will see that you are enrolled, eligible for care. So being in touch with us before you depart Iceland is paramount.
Thank you, sir. Captain Lawton?
Another question on Icelandic car registration. How's it being handled? Same process as normal. As I said before, you'll have to pay for it, and if you're going to operate the vehicle, that's a cost of operating. Insurance, on the other hand, you're going to be charged up front for your 6 months of insurance. Then as you start the checkout process and turn in your tags and stuff and take your paperwork back to the insurance company, you should be prorated and receive back the unused portion of your insurance.
Okay. Gentlemen, do you have any final comments? Colonel Croxton, sir?
Sure. We're at 1177 right now, military members on the base. Next month, it'll probably be below 1,000. And the following months, you'll see the reductions keep on going. So we're at the start of the push, and just want to let everyone know that everyone's been very cooperative, the Air Force and Navy. We're playing well together in the small sandbox or icebox we have here in Iceland, and it's been a pleasure to watch to see how we're tackling the problem and getting out of town.
Thank you, sir. Captain Lawton?
I would just remind folks that there's a couple of events that are going on around the base that are going to bring some heightened media interest. Remind folks that if they find themselves with a microphone in front of their face or somebody with a piece of paper and asking questions, the proper response to that is to refer them to the IDF PAO shop. And I would, as Colonel Croxton said, applaud everybody's efforts thus far. There's been a huge amount of work done. Folks are out there working hard, but working smart, and working, more importantly, safely. Haven't seen any indicators of folks taking shortcuts or trying to bypass any of the procedures that we have in place, and I applaud everybody's effort for that.
Thank you, sir. Colonel Gibbons?
I would just like to echo the comments they said and kind of round us back to where we started. The Air Force side has generated a lot of orders, especially over the last week, and I'm asking that everybody keep a good humor about it, because there are a few individuals that are getting slightly frustrated with the process. I don't think it's through any fault of the MSS and of our assignment folks and from the Navy folks that we're working to get the people out of here. But hey, keep a good sense of humor about you, and we'll get through this process together and we'll make it happen.
Thank you, sir. Captain McCartan?
Well, it may seem like we may have coordinated this before we went on the air, but it's not the case. But I also had anticipated and just want to thank people for their cooperation. As we've put things out at the hospital in terms of what we needed folks to do to be in touch, to stay ahead of the power curve, people have been very cooperative. We're extremely busy in both the hospital and at the dental clinic. But as a result, we are ahead of the surge. People are getting the care they needed. They're getting things signed off. People are getting their prescriptions filled. So I think if we can just stay on track as we are and safely, as Captain Lawton mentioned, we're going to do fine through this.
Thank you, gentlemen, for being here. And remember, if you tuned in late or if one of your coworkers is talking about it tomorrow and says, oh, I missed Icebreaker, you can tune in Thursday at 6 right here on Channel 21 to catch the re-airing, the encore presentation.
The answers will be the same.
The encore presentation of these wonderful answers. And tune in next week, Tuesday at 7 o'clock, for your chance to ask your questions. Thank you so much for tuning in. And also, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done that. Look for us out and about, and thank you for tuning in.
The Navy Weather Office is predicting a 100% chance of a real music variety on K104.1.
Oh, playing you the greatest rock and roll ever made, Jeff Gonza with Metallica, The Unforgiven. And Cheap Trick, new album from Cheap Trick due out in June. And The Scorpions, No One Like You, Deep Purple on the way. I'm getting ready to say goodbye. Mick Jagger apparently is quite the actor. Well, he's been in many movies, some of them real stinkers, some of them very forgettable, some of them pretty good, but Jagger is now part of this brand new sitcom that's probably going to be on ABC with a working title of Let's Rob Mick Jagger. And the producer of the show saying, Mick is a very funny guy. A lot of ad-lib lines. They'll change the name if it makes it to television, but that's basically the premise. Hapless crooks trying to rob Mick Jagger. Whatever. More and more Americans are using Head-On. Head-On products are available without a prescription at retailers nationwide. Should you know about Head-On, it's guaranteed or your money back. Try Head-On today. Talk to you tomorrow.
AFN Radio. CNN Radio, I'm Stan Case. 10 states are taking the federal government to court over gas mileage requirements for pickup trucks and sport utility vehicles. California Attorney General Bill Lockyer says the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration has not done enough to promote fuel economy and the environment.
We think they ought to go back to the drawing board, help us get better mileage, more gasoline available, and a more serious effort at global warming.
The Bush administration recently announced new rules that would require better gas mileage for pickups and SUVs. Relatives of 12 men killed in January's West Virginia coal mining disaster tell a team of investigators they want some answers to lingering questions. Pam Campbell, whose brother-in-law was among the 12 victims, says the families deserve to know the truth.
We expect to get answers to these questions. And so far, these answers have not come.
The lone survivor, Randy McCloy, sent other family members a letter last week saying four of the emergency oxygen packs did not work properly. New Orleans officials plan to use buses and Amtrak trains to evacuate the city the next time it's threatened by a major hurricane. Mayor Ray Nagin says everyone must get out.
There will be no shelter of last resort in the event of a major hurricane that's coming our way.
Hurricane season begins June 1st. Maryland prosecutors have a new star witness as they prepare for the next murder trial of convicted D.C. area sniper John Muhammad. Reporter Neil Augenstein of affiliate WTOP tells us Muhammad's accomplice will testify against him.
Lee Malvo, his attorney, and prosecutors have met half a dozen times, both at the jail and in the prosecutor's office here in Montgomery County. And what we've learned is that Malvo will testify against John Muhammad, and then he'll plead guilty to six murders here in Montgomery County.
Muhammad is already facing the death penalty in Virginia. The most trusted name in news, this is CNN Radio.
More than 17,000 Americans die each year from alcohol-related incidents. Don't become a statistic. Before heading out for a night on the town, make sure you have a plan for getting home safely. Take advantage of designated drivers and taxi services. And when you're out with friends, drink responsibly. Remember, binge drinking can kill. Every member of Team Keflavik is an important part of our community. Make sure you're taking steps toward responsible drinking.
Even though most miles are never claimed. Each year, nearly 700 million passengers board the nation's airliners. Their average trip is 1,050 miles. The most traveled route is from New York City to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, a trip made by close to 4 million people annually. You can find these and more facts about America from the U.S. Census Bureau on the web at census.gov.
Before the Army's Golden Knights parachute team can free fall through space, four other team members perform their job as parachute riggers. With extensive training in aerodynamics, they know how parachutes work and why. The riggers inspect and repair the chutes and pack the reserve chutes, well aware that their team members' lives are in their hands. They're another example of the professionalism that takes place every day in the United States military.
Although you can't be here,
the purpose of this convention is to nominate our candidate for
you can still participate in every federal, state, and local election for which you're eligible. Your voting assistance officer has the information you need on upcoming election dates, procedures for registering or casting an absentee ballot. So even though you're thousands of miles from all this...
And how do the people of the great state of Ohio cast their vote?
Your voting assistance officer will make sure your voice is heard.
Time has come to make a choice.
K-104. 104.1 FM, Keflavik, Iceland.
Listening to the American Forces Network.
You know, Tuesdays are terrific around here. Did you know that? Well, you do now. Tony checking in.